Thank you for watching Friendship Community Church Sermons on Demand. We're pleased you have decided to view our pulpit messages. Our Sermons on Demand are a ministry of Friendship Community Church and are provided as a resource to anyone who desires to study the Word of God. So open your Bible and get ready to dig into the Word of God and see what God has for you today. We covered last week, we gave you the breakdown of the Hebrew Scriptures, what we refer to as the Old Testament. We took a look at the approximate years of the minor prophets when they wrote, and we included for you on the screen, not there today, but on the screen last week, the basic biblical timeline, so you had an idea of when they fell into the timeline. And then we didn't go over it, but it's provided for you in the book. Predictive elements in the minor prophets, how much of their of the book is actually predictive and how much is historical. And you can see from that list that Jonah is only 10% predictive. It is more of a historical narrative, and has been questioned by some of whether or not it should actually be in the minor prophets. And we discussed how they got into the minor prophets and so forth. And then the last thing we looked at last week very briefly was the timeline provided for you on page 16. So any questions about minor prophets?
Comments?
Comments, okay. Thanks. A lot of blood, sweat, and tears went into getting this done on time. It was, what's that?
What a hoser.
Yeah, just so many things are teed up right there that I'm just going to leave it alone.
That's Hosea.
Oh.
It's an
A. You have been spanked. So, Hosea, the first in our list of minor prophets, I went in the order that they appear in our English Bibles. This is, as you can tell from the list on page 11, not the oldest and not the newest of the prophets. So they're not in chronological order. They're in the order that they are in our English Bible, which may or may not follow the Hebrew Scriptures. There's a debate about that. You would think we would be able to tell. Does it follow or does it not? Well, yes and no. So our modern Hebrew Bibles include it in the order of our English Bibles. Historical Hebrew Scriptures don't include it in the same order, so... As with most of the, all of the minor prophets, the title of the book comes from the main character of the book, the actual prophet himself. The name of the author is Hosea, which means welfare or salvation. And according to Numbers 13:8, that was Joshua's original name. Welfare or salvation. And it's also the last king of Israel, his name. And it is the same as Jesus' real name. When I say real name, I should phrase that as Hebrew name. The way it would have been in Hebrew rather than Aramaic or in Greek. And so it is a rather common name. It is a name that we see a lot in Scripture. But of the author himself, we have very little information. The only source of information about the author is the book himself. You know, frequently, the authors of the books of the Bible, we have information about them in other books. but some of them, a lot of the minor prophets, we know very little about. We know that we only know what we know from the book of Hosea. There are other people mentioned as Hosea that are not in the right time frame, that can't be the right one. We need to set the stage kind of in order to get an idea of the date of the writing of the book of Hosea. Israel was in an age of prosperity. They had been growing exponentially. They had been profitable. Despite the fact that all the kings were bad, Israel was in a good spot, and they had been growing economically. They had grown some geographically as well. And as a result, this was the most profitable time period for Israel. Remember, that's the 10 tribes to the north. It's following the divided, the time of the United Kingdom, the United Monarchy, and we have the kings to the north ruling all of them bad. And this was the most profitable time for Israel since the time of Solomon, the last king of the United Monarchy. The problem with prosperity, as we have discovered in our own country, is it brings also moral decay. And for the Israelites, moral decay also meant serious idolatry. Verse 1 of chapter 1 indicates that Hosea's prophetic career began during the reign of Jeroboam II, who ruled Israel from 793 to 753. Hosea's prophetic career ended sometime during the reign of Hezekiah, who ruled 729 until 686 BC. I'm going to suggest that his prophetic career ended early in Hezekiah's reign because of what we see in the text and what we know happened during the time period. So it's believed that his career ended early in Hezekiah's reign. Hosea was most likely, although we don't know because it's not said in the text, it appears like he was from Israel, that he was truly an Israelite from the northern tribes, although we're not sure. It's, as I state in the text, it's a conjecture based upon the fact that he shows familiarity with Israel's history and with its geography. Had he been a Judean, he may not have been as familiar with what was going on. If in fact Hosea was from the northern kingdom of Israel, he was one of two writing prophets from Israel. All the other prophets were from Judah. They may have reported, prophesied for the north, but they were actually from Judah. He would be one of two. The only other one would be Jonah. If in fact Hosea is from Israel, he and Jonah are the only ones. The book of Hosea is kind of autobiographical in its writing, and probably the most of all the minor prophets. It is, I think, one of the most tragic books because of what God requires this poor man to do. God instructed Hosea to take as his wife a prostitute by the name of Gomer. That's wrong on so many levels for those of us that grew up in the 60s. To have a wife named Gomer just makes the wrong connotations in your brain. Probably wasn't the same way for him, but he still had to take a wife as a prostitute. No, a prostitute as a wife. Yeah, he could get in trouble going the other way. This marriage brought Hosea tremendous heartache, as you can imagine. And it was all designed as a picture of how Israel treated God. So you have this poor guy called by God, go find you this wife, this prostitute, make her your wife, and she's going to go out with other guys. And it's going to be illustrative of the relationship of Israel with God. I'm not sure I'm doing that if God's calling me to do that. I'm very glad he's not calling me to do that.
So she continued to be a prostitute?
She continued to be. There's some debate about that, but I think it's pretty clear in the text that she continued to be a prostitute. But one of the things that what happens when we study these texts is less than very conservative scholars want to make it less structured and less sure. And so they say, well, maybe she wasn't a prostitute anymore. And then they try to prove that. But I think it's pretty clear. She remained a prostitute throughout. And it's interesting that if you don't take a historical, grammatical, literal interpretation of the scripture, a lot of positions you have to monkey with the text in order to make it come out right to suit you. And if you take a literal, grammatical, historical view of it, you don't have to do that. And I think the text very clearly tells us she remained a prostitute. She had children, maybe of prostitution, maybe of Hosea. That's not real, real clear. But as a result, Hosea had kids that he had to take care of. And that, I mean, it's a perfect picture of the relationship of Israel with God. That's why God had Hosea go through this. Although Hosea was from Israel, he wrote or spoke about both Israel and Judah. He prophesied that there would be trouble forthcoming for both Israel and for Judah. The moral conditions in Israel had rapidly deteriorated after the death of Jeroboam II. Not that Jeroboam II was a good guy. He wasn't. But I don't think there's necessarily causality in Jeroboam's death. Timing. Anarchy prevailed during this period as Israel moved further and further away from God. And I think that's what we're in store for in our country as we move further and further from God if we don't get things back on track. At the same time, concurrently with what was going on in Israel after the death of Jeroboam II, we have a deteriorating of things going on in Judah as well. King Uzziah had usurped the priestly role. You can see reference to that in 2 Chronicles chapter 26. And was struck by God with leprosy. That's a pretty bad thing when your king, who runs everything, he is the sovereign of the nation, when he's got leprosy, and he's being punished by God. Your government can't function very well. The next Judean king, Jotham, continued to lead Judah away from God and from his worship. And Ahaz then advocated the worship of Baal. So we've got Judah going off the deep end as Israel is also going into anarchy. That was the environment that Hosea prophesies in. You've got the prosperity of Israel collapsing after Jeroboam's death. And then you have a series of bad guys, kings in Judah. And so you have this total destruction going on in both Israel and Judah. The historical thoughts or historical and theological themes in the book, we're going to try to bring that out in every book. God's love for Israel in spite of Israel's idolatry is pictured in Hosea's love for his wife, Gomer, but her insistence on returning and being a prostitute, and the heartache that is for Hosea. Hosea illustrates that God's love for Israel is unending and enduring. It's actually a comforting book by the time you get to the end, but it's pretty frustrating as we read through it. If you remember when we read through it earlier this year, it's kind of frustrating to see what God puts up with in the nation of Israel. I'm also including in each section or in each book some interpretive challenges. What are the primary things that we struggle with to get right in the book? Some scholars suggest that the marital scenes of chapter 1 through 3 should be taken as allegory. You know, here, this is what I was talking about earlier. They don't want to say that God would actually tell somebody to marry a prostitute, so it's going to be allegory. I've got a lot of problem with taking large sections of obvious narrative and making it allegorical, unless it's clearly meant to be allegorical. And every section of allegory in Scripture seems to me is pretty well shown to be allegorical if it's allegorical. These same scholars would take Genesis 1 to 11 and make it allegorical, when clearly it's narrative. All of the genre indicators mean it's narrative, just like they do here. And so that's one of the problems we have. They suggest that it should be allegorical and not actual history. So they're suggesting this is a nice story. This is not what actually happened. Now, we have to be very careful about groups that allegorize Scripture so much. There's nothing in the text or in the way the text is presented to cause us to believe it would be allegorical. There's nothing. And you, as you've been reading through the Scripture, you've seen those places where obviously it's an allegorical statement, or it's a visionary statement, and it's not a narrative of history. But this section is clearly historical narrative. The reality is that the impact of the first section of the book of Hosea would be lost if it was an actual history. If God didn't tell Hosea to go out and marry Gomer the prostitute, the rest of the book would be less impactful, because it would have just been a story that we respond to. It would have been like trying to teach morality to your kids by using fairy tales. That doesn't work. It's got to be actual stuff. There's also a suggestion that God would not instruct Hosea to position to such a position of moral compromise to marry a known prostitute. I'm not sure that that's a valid statement. It is not the normal ideal for everyone, but God does do some things like that when, in order to prove a point and teach a lesson. And as we go through our verse by verse, we'll see further into that. Some scholars also argue that the woman in chapter 3 is a different woman than Gomer in chapter 1. I looked at this real closely because that kind of intrigued me, but there is nothing that I can see in the text that would lead us to that conclusion. And we'll get there. We'll look at that as we get a little closer. I have given you the outline of the book, and the outlines that I used throughout our study. I'm not a good outliner, and so I just go ahead and use somebody else's that is a good outliner. And this comes from all of the outlines that we're going to use in our study come from the MacArthur Study Bible. In the beginning of each book, they have an outline. Okay, like how come we have so many ones? That turned out nice. So the second one should be A, and two should be B. And then three should be two. Wow.
We have three is C in the book.
Yeah, three is C, right. It's good that you have it in your book, because I copied it right out of the book, so Proclaim must have changed that. Interesting. Never seen it do that, and that's kind of cool. Anyway, it's in your book. It's in your book properly. Wow. So any questions on the title, author, background, or interpretive challenges or historical themes? Okay, let's get started then in our verse by verse, and we'll go verse by verse pretty much through all of the minor prophets. verse 1, the word of the Lord came to Hosea, the son of Beeri, or Beeri, the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. Notice that Hosea opens with identification of the source of the prophecy. I love this. The word of the Lord. Listen up, folks. This comes from God is what Hosea is saying. Now, we don't know how he presented this to the people. Probably he presented it orally, maybe in the hearing of the king. We don't know for certain. But he makes it clear in his writings and probably in his speaking, the word of the Lord. I'm responding or repeating to you, Hosea says, the word of the Lord, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. He gives a little bit of a biographical sketch of himself, that he's the son of Beeri. And we have enough information to be able to know when he's writing. You know, because we know the general dates of the kings of Israel and Judah. So we have a pretty good glimpse. And you can go back to page, I think it was 11. Yeah, page 11. And see the approximate date of this. He's writing just before the conquest of Israel. I shouldn't say the conquest, because that's when they took it, Palestine. I should say when Israel was taken by Assyria in 722. So he's writing probably 2 or 3 years before Israel is taken captive. Verse 2. When the Lord began to speak by Hosea, the Lord said to Hosea, go take yourself a wife of harlotry and children of harlotry, for the land has committed great harlotry by departing from the Lord. From the beginning of his ministry, he was directed by God to go out and find Gomer, or to find a wife who was a harlot. There is a movie available on Netflix and Xfinity, Streamcast or Steam, whatever it is, called Hosea. It's pretty good. They add a lot into it to make it more interesting, but it's pretty consistent with the way the book goes. He was being told by God to marry a prostitute and to have children of a prostitute. Now, the description in the New King James, go take yourself a wife of harlotry and children of harlotry. Some surmise that the children were already alive. It doesn't seem likely that that's the case, but some allege that. And I think as we go through, we'll see that that's not true. There's considerable debate among Old Testament scholars as to when Gomer became a prostitute. Some argue that she became a prostitute after they were married, in which case he's probably not a very good guy. I mean, his mental health has to be pretty low if your wife leaves you and becomes a prostitute. I mean, just how damaging to a guy is that, right? I agree with you. But those are the kinds of arguments that biblical scholars have. And I don't think it helps the case any. I don't think it solves any problems by saying she became a prostitute after, although some scholars argue that. And they're not all liberal scholars that argue that, which I'm a little bit surprised at, because the literal reading of the text is she's already a prostitute. But some argue differently, and you just have to know that. Some argue she was already an adulterous prostitute at the time Hosea married her. While others argue that God's command to Hosea was predictive of what Gomer would become. I don't think we have any indication in the text that would that Gomer would become a prostitute, but that she already was. I think that's fairly clear. I think we might also consider that she may have been a temple prostitute engaged in the worship of Baal. The Net Bible has the following note on verse 2. The plural noun, zenunim, literally harlotries, is an example of the plural of character or the plural of repeated behavior. The phrase wife of harlotries probably refers to a prostitute, possibly a temple prostitute serving at Baal temple. Now, that compounds the situation, but makes it even better as a descriptor of what Israel was doing. If she was a temple prostitute in the worship of Baal, what better to illustrate that she or that Israel is following the Baals instead of God? I mean, that makes the picture even better and more well defined. Verse 3. So we went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. Hosea married Gomer as God directed. Also tells Gomer, or verse 3 also tells us that Gomer had her first child, a son. Some scholars try to make it that I think they're trying to protect God from making somebody sin. I think that's the underlying reason that they try to make it that they say, well, he never actually married her. So God didn't force him to commit adultery. I just can't read that into the text. It just doesn't seem like that. When it says, so he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim. I think the indication of the text is he married her. But some argue that she didn't, that he didn't. I think that's an argument that I don't think works. But
you said he would commit adultery,
not that he because he's marrying a woman that is an adulterous woman.
She's committing the adultery. He's faithful.
No. It's like a sticky stain. It gets everybody that's involved. Yeah, but she was an adulterous one, so, I mean, it's like Ebola. The stain of adultery would get on him because she was an adulterous one.
Why couldn't it be the stain of faithfulness would be on him?
It could be. But that's not the illustration God was painting, is it?
Well, she is representing Israel.
Right. I'm not saying that that's the case. I'm arguing for why the people are trying to keep God or keep him from actually marrying her.
Right.
No, it's a perfect illustration of what was going on in the nation. Israel was following the Baal, so he picks up a prostitute and marries her. And is like you say, faithful to her. That's the picture God wanted Israel to see. But some argue that he didn't actually marry her, so there wasn't that stain. But that doesn't work, I don't think. I don't think the text allows that. But they argue that anyway.
Then he would be living in sin, because he would be with her without being married.
Yeah, but God wouldn't be on the hook for making him marry her.
That's ridiculous.
Welcome to the world of study in the Old Testament. While you're back there, will you tune my guitar? Just kidding. Yeah.
So if he hadn't married her, he would have been in
the... Yeah. But I think the pressure is, the purpose is to take the pressure off of God. God doesn't need our help that way. But some of these Old Testament scholars confuse me in their gymnastics in how to get around things. Verse 4 and 5. Then the Lord said to me, call his name Jezreel, for in a little while I will avenge the bloodshed of Jezreel on the house of Jehu and bring an end to the kingdom of the house of Israel. It shall come to pass in that day that I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel. God instructed Hosea to name the firstborn son of Gomer Jezreel, because God would punish the house of Jehu. Not Jehu himself, but his dynasty in power in Israel. The punishment to the family of Jehu was because it was in the city of Jezreel that Jehu slaughtered the descendants of Ahab. You can read that in 2 Kings 9. Not only will God punish the dynasty of Jehu, he'll also bring to an end the nation of Israel. A prediction of what would come in just a few short years at the hand of the Assyrians. Most of the kings in Israel's history, I'm talking about the 10 tribes to the north, most of their kings took power by being the strongest. There were a couple of periods where we have two or three descendants of the previous king taking power, and that's what came to an end when the Assyrians took over. There had been a short dynasty, not near as long as the Davidic dynasty in Judah, which was consistent all through Judah's history. Normally in Israel, whoever had the biggest sword and the most power became king. But there were a few times when sons or grandsons or brothers took over. So God says, look, here's the punishment that's coming. We're going to name the first kid Jezreel because that's going to symbolize why Israel is going to be defeated. Verse 6, and she came for a daughter. Then God said to him, call her name Lo-Ruhamah, for I will no longer have mercy on the house of Israel. A daughter is born. Hosea is instructed to call the baby girl Lo-Ruhamah, or no mercy. That's pretty, insightful. It's pretty instructive. Listen, Israel, her name is going to be No Mercy. God says, I'm not going to have any mercy on you. I'm past the mercy time. Yes, sir?
Sidlow Baxter translates that as the little girl who never knew her father's love.
Yeah. What's that? Yeah, not love, yeah. Yep. The picture that Hosea, Gomer, and the kids gives to Israel is pretty instructive. Whether or not they saw it is a different story. Whether or not they actually recognized what God was doing is something a little different. Yes, sir?
To him, this first child, and the others just sort of came along. Now imagine Gomer brings this baby home, and it looks nothing like Hosea. I mean, it's got redhead, red hair, and freckles. Would that be part of the picture that Hosea had a hard time warming up to this child, thinking this isn't mine, the next one's not mine? I don't know. I've seen situations where fathers like that could figure, the baby's not the one at fault here. I'm going to love this baby. But I think part of the picture here is that Hosea just has a hard time accepting this child as his own.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a picture of God's rejection of Israel's harlotries.
And that's part of the debate. Are those children actually his or not? That debate rages among Old Testament prophet scholars. Right. Yeah, right. We need to remember that Israel had a binding contract. They were under a contract with God, a covenant. That contract or covenant said that as long as Israel followed and served God, he would protect them and bless them. But when they did not, he would, or he could, punish them, including removing them from the land, which is what Hosea was saying was going to happen. You know, the important part of the message is, you've not followed God, and as a result, you're going to lose, and the dynasty of Jehu comes to an end. And in less than 3 years from this prophecy, Assyria comes and conquers the 10 northern tribes, and they basically cease to exist as an entity. We don't see them as a tribal entity again in Scripture. You know, you read about, there's all sorts of conspiracy theories and all sorts of theories about what happened to the 10 tribes and where they went. We don't know. Most of them remained in Assyria and Assyrian-held territory, and some of them came back after the Babylonian captivity. But we really don't have a fix on what happened to the 10 tribes. They basically cease to exist. Well, God somehow puts them back together in the future, but at this point, we don't know where they are, we don't know who they are. And so they're paying the price for their violation of the covenant. Verse 7, yet I'll have mercy on the house of Judah. Verse 6, I'll have no mercy. Verse 7, yet I'll have mercy on the house of Judah, will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword or battle, by horses or horsemen. In contrast to having mercy, not having mercy on the tribes to the north, Hosea says that God will have mercy on the tribes to the south. Assyria conquered in 722. When Assyria came through Israel, they decided, hey, we're on a roll. Let's go right into Judah. And they marched down out of through Samaria, or what would become Samaria, into Judah. And they took a bunch of cities in Judah at the time. And they conquered that northern part of Judah at the same time as they took Assyria. But in 701 BC, God supernaturally killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers in one night. And Assyria said, nah, we're out of here. We're done. Their God is greater, and we're just not going to go any further here. And so for a period of time, part of Judah was captured like Israel was. You can read about that great event in 2 Kings 19. So when Hosea prophesies, the Lord will save them, their God, and will not save them by bow, it was a mysterious thing why these 185,000 soldiers died on one night. It wasn't just that they were killed by the Judeans. It was a miracle. And that's exactly as Hosea had prophesied. Verse 8 and 9. Now, when she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, she conceived and bore a son. Then God said, call his name Lo-Ami, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. That had to be a shock, although I don't think it shocked them at all. It should have shocked them. Gomer conceives and has another child, a son, Lo-Ami, which means, know my people. Not my people. That should be not my people, not know my people. Should be not my people. The covenant between God and Israel declared God was their God and they were his people. And you see the references where that is given. The literal translation of the last clause of verse 9 is, I am not I am to you. The God who told Moses, when Moses said, who do I say sent me? I am sent you. And the God I am says to the people of Israel, not I am to you. In other words, the bind, the contract, the covenant between us, it's broken. Exactly. What a tragedy that was for Israel. But that's what Hosea is telling them is going to happen. The phrase I am to the Jews was special. It was something that God was to them that he wasn't to anybody else. And for God to say, not I am to you. Well, the impact of just that is a tremendously difficult thing for them to take. I think that is some of the hardest language in the prophets. When God says, we're not anything to anybody to each other anymore. We're done. The divorce is final. We've walked away.
Nowhere in the rest of the Hebrew canon is that canceled.
No.
And the fact that Hosea is moved by the Holy Spirit to use the Hebrew prefix lo instead of la, lo means not now, not ever. Or henceforth, not to be. And until God does a new covenant with Israel, that's going to be the case.
Well, he has a new covenant in place. It's just not, it has been signed but not ratified.
Right. It awaits ratification.
Yeah. And I think in some theological sense, that's why those people are not known, why the tribes have gone. And why we don't know where they are, and we don't know anything about them. And until the new covenant for them is ratified and in place, we won't know. But I can't overemphasize the fact that God says to them, I am not yours anymore. That's a big deal. Don't equate that to Christians, to our understanding of salvation. God can't say that to us because we have a different covenant than they did. They had a covenant that required some action. We don't. So don't think this means that you can lose your salvation, because it doesn't. Any questions on the first 10 verses? Feathers. I should say the first 9 verses. No questions? Yeah, I know, they're good. I was watching as it was fixing. They're good. No questions? Okay, let's pray. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to spend some time studying your word. Thank you that you did not say to us, I am not yours anymore. You can't even say that to us. You have made an agreement with us forever, for eternity, and that we are yours for eternity. What a blessing that is. Give us a great hour or period of time to follow where we can worship you and honor you as we study your word some more, and as we fellowship together, and as we worship you through song. Thank you for these people that are here. Thank you for the time we can spend together. We love you, and we want to serve you in Jesus' name. Thank you for watching this sermon on demand at Friendship Community Church. If this message has been helpful to you in your understanding of the Word of God, please let folks at Friendship Community Church know by sending an email to watching@friendshipcomchurch.org. Thank you again for watching, and we look forward to seeing you in person at Friendship Community Church.